Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Up a Tree, written by Sherryl Clark and read by Melissa Eccleston. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. The dedication reads, For Leslie. Chapter 1. The Grubb twins' flying fox was up at Granite Gorge, above the river where the rocks stick up like big teeth. They had nicked about 100 metres of rope off their dad. The last week of school, all we heard about was this flying fox, how dangerous it was, how everyone would be too chicken to go on it. It wasn't like the ones we built at school camp over little gullies, they said. Their flying fox would scare the pants off everyone. We all said, yeah, sure, and tried to pretend we didn't care 2 cents about their stupid fox, but all the time everyone was busting to get up the gorge and have a look. It takes half an hour to walk all that way up the river, but it means no adults around to spoil the fun. That's what the Grubb twins said anyway. Me, I was curious, but I'd seen Grubb disasters before, and listening to them skite about it made my ears prickle. I should have known my dur-brain brother Simon wasn't so smart. School was out, yes! Most of us reckoned we'd sneak up the gorge sometime over the weekend for a look, but Simon took off as soon as the bell rang. Take my bag home, Molly, he said, slinging it at me. Where are you going? I said. Up the gorge. I'm going to be first to try out that fox. You can't! Dad'll kill you if he finds out. What am I supposed to tell Mum? He shrugged, but I could tell from his face that he wasn't too sure about what he was doing. Why do you have to be first? I asked. Because I'm always last. It's true, he is. Not in school, because he's clever enough, but in everything else around our town. He's no good at footy or tennis. He hates running and he's scared of heights, so the other kids leave him out of a lot of things. I could see that being first on the flying fox would score him a lot of points. Hang on, I said. No one will be there to see you, and you know they won't believe it otherwise. Well, I thought... He kicked at the stones on the road and raised a small dust storm. If you came with me, you could sort of be my witness. Oh, great, then Dad will kill both of us. No way. Then I thought about Simon's fear of heights and how far above the river the fox would be, and I changed my mind. Someone had to save him. All right, I grumbled. But you'd better not be a slow coach on the track, otherwise we won't get home until dark, and Mum will guess we've been up to something. Thanks, Moll. He beamed at me as we stowed our school bags under the bushes by the school gate. The other kids had long since gone. Once school was out for the Christmas holidays, they couldn't wait to get clear of the place. We headed down to the river, trying not to look like we were in a hurry, but once we got to the track, we started running. That didn't last long, because Simon panted and puffed like the old steam engine that came through every so often. Oh, slow down, he said, stopping and bending over. Oh, I've got a stitch already. 2 minutes rest, I said, and counted it on my watch. Come on! I didn't make him run again, but we walked pretty fast. I could hear him gasping behind me, but I was more worried about the Grubb's flying fox. They'd skited about how high and long it was, how you could get up to 40 kilometres an hour on it. Like I believed that. But if it was across Granite Gorge, it must be high. What if Simon fell off? What if he went so fast he couldn't stop at the other end? What if the rope broke? Mum always said I was good at creating panic when none existed, but I couldn't help it. I just worried about stuff a lot, especially where Simon was concerned. What on earth had made him decide to do this? He'd been happily making all of us miserable with his Knights and Dragons obsession for ages. It was embarrassing, but since he's a year younger than me, I just pretend I don't know him. And then thump anyone who gives me a hard time. I mean, How would you like a brother who insists everyone call him Sir Simon and wears a silver helmet and sticky tapes a shield to his school bag? Not very cool at all. I wanted to stop and ask him what was going on, why this was such a big deal for him. Then I checked my watch and decided it was more important to keep moving. Time was running out. Dad would be on his way home, or already there and washing the truck out the back. Mum would be finishing her Friday shift in the deli at the supermarket in town and picking out what cold meat we'd have for tea. My stomach gurgled at the thought and I hoped she'd pick salami. The track was getting narrower and the trees towered over us. We were right in the bush now, a long way from any houses, and we were heading up a slope. I could see the start of the gorge ahead, two big rocks that leant together and left a gap between that we could just squeeze through. Then we were in the actual gorge and the track got very steep. We had to haul ourselves up, over tree roots and broken branches, to the point near the top where the grub said they'd set up the rope. It was a clear area on a flat, round rock with a huge gum tree behind it. I staggered out onto the rock, my legs feeling wobbly like I'd run two cross-country races. Simon fell on the ground behind me. "I think my lungs are going to explode," he gasped. "Maybe that would be a better way to die," I said. "Look!" I pointed at the rope that was tied exactly where the grubs had said it was. For once, I truly wished they'd been lying. It spun out over the gorge like a strand of spider's web, vibrating a bit in the breeze that riffled through the gap. Far, far away on the other side, it was tied to another huge gum tree. At least the trees weren't likely to come crashing down, just the morons who rode the fox. "Ugh." Now Simon did sound like he was being strangled. He'd turned a funny shade of off-white and he was grabbing at the collar of his shirt without even knowing he was doing it. I knew exactly how he felt. "You're not going to do this, are you?" I said. No one would be that crazy. "Yes." "What? Look at that rope. Look how far down it is. Look at the grubs' stupid fox." I pulled it down from where it had been hooked on the tree. It was a branch, debarked and tied with another piece of rope to a pulley. "It'll probably break under you. What will you hold on to then?" "Sean Grubb said he'd been on it half a dozen times and he's a lot heavier than me."
"He's also a lot stupider than you. And he doesn't have a mother who'll murder him like ours will when she finds out."
Well, actually, Sean did have a mother, but she seemed to have very little say in what the Grubb twins got up to. Simon got that look on his face then, sticking his chin out and pulling his eyebrows down.
"I have to do it."
"Why?"
"Because."
"Why because?"
Because.
I knew from long experience that this could go on and on until we had enough becauses to make my brain spin.
"Simon, just tell me, or I'm going home right now and you'll have to die without me watching."
"Bugs Popovich dared me,"
he said in a small voice. "Why?"
"Of course."
"Not that again."
"Simon."
"All right. Because when we got changed for sports the other day, he saw me underpants."
"So?"
He closed his mouth tight and I punched him on the arm.
"Spit it out," I said.
"They were your undies."
Chapter 2.
"Pardon?"
I stared at him. "What were you doing wearing my undies?" All sorts of horrible thoughts started jumping around in my head, but I could see Simon was nearly crying, so I pushed them away.
"Come on, you can tell me."
"It was the morning we were late for school because Nikki dropped that jar of jam on the floor. I grabbed my jeans and undies out of the washing pile and got dressed really quickly. I didn't notice they weren't mine."
Which ones were they?"
I had some favourites and I really hoped he hadn't worn one of those pairs because I already knew I'd have to throw them out.
His face turned bright red.
The ones Grandma Mavie gave you, with the pink pigs on them.
Thank goodness. I hated them. They had old-fashioned lace around the legs. I think Grandma Mavie made them herself. She's always saying shop-bought clothes are cheap and nasty.
Okay, so Bugs saw them. Why didn't you just explain?
Yeah, right.
I knew what he meant. Bugs wasn't the sort of person you could explain things to logically. He was from the shoot first, ask questions later school of how things work.
So, I glanced at my watch. We had to decide now what Simon was going to do.
It's only a stupid dare.
Well, just say you did it. I saw you, no problem. Now let's go home.
I'll know I haven't done it. I won't be able to lie good like you can.
Well, yes, it is one of my greater talents, I said.
But still, why would you kill yourself on this thing rather than just avoid Bugs for the next 100 years?
I accepted the dare, and if I don't do it, to prove I'm not a wuss, I have to give him my bike.
Ugh.
Now it was my turn to choke. Half that
bike. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.